Welcome to the Underground, the Steel City Underground, the black and gold standard for Pittsburgh Steelers coverage. Now, here are your hosts, Joe Kuzma and Brian E. Roach.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Steel City Underground podcast. Today's episode brought to you by Total Sports Enterprises and their big signing with multiple Steelers signing autographs this upcoming week before the home opener, September 15th at the Mall at Robinson. Some more details later on for that event. My name is Joe Kuzma, and yes, I know some people are like, wow, you have like a different sponsor or partner or whatever every episode, and that was really a good thing for us right now. So but don't forget, there's the Jaguars tailgate going on, and of course our other great partners, MyBookie and TicketIQ, I'll give a shout out to as well. Business booming for Steel City Underground. Business not so booming, Brian, for the Pittsburgh Steelers in a kiss your sister type matchup, and we've got lots to discuss here. But first of all, let me ask you. Oh, I guess you're still alive over there. I haven't had a heart attack. You haven't had a heart attack yet.
No, I have not had a heart attack. I have, at least to my knowledge,
anxiety.
Yeah, I've had a lot of anxiety.
Hey, never, ever, 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 never, ever, 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 never make it easy. I mean, we said this game was going to be ugly. For those of you who may have even heard the interview I had with the folks up in Cleveland on Channel 19 WOIO back on Thursday, I was asked a few different questions about the game. One of them was, do Steelers fans feel entitled to a victory here? I said, they feel entitled to every victory. I said, the line on this game for my bookie was, Steelers minus -4. I feel it'll probably be somewhere within that. It's AFC North football. We knew the weather forecast wasn't going to be pleasant. We also knew there's going to be preseason jitters. And yeah, it was pretty ugly. I'm going to get this out the way right now. I'm not laying anything on the defense. Not one thing really on the defense. I thought they did a solid job, even the scores that were given up. Again, you're playing against other professional football teams. Josh Gordon's touchdown. I mean, you saw Cam Sutton pretty much in the best position he could be in. And then they try to go to the well again, and Cam Sutton comes up with a pick, nearly the savior of that game. No, I really want to rest my laurels on a 51.4 QB rating from Ben Roethlisberger, going 23 of 41, four picks, however many turnovers, the number of penalties in this game, and the fact that they just didn't – neither team really wanted to win this one. But it's like, you know, you thought that the Steelers did just enough, and then the Wizard of Oz deals – it looked like a high snap to Jordan Berry, and the kick was pulled, and maybe weather has something to do with that or whatever on the 42-yard try. But you thought – I had it in my bold predictions. I thought it was going to be close. I thought there was going to be a lot of penalties. I thought the Steelers were going to get a lot of sacks. They did all those things except for – Chris Boswell hitting the game winner.
Yeah, this is – as the game started to progress, you kind of just got this feeling that this was – everything was going to be the opposite of what it should be. Boswell gets a chance to win the game. Of course, he will miss the kick. The Browns get a chance to win the game. Of course, the kick is blocked. Here's a stat – this is a stat that I think – speaks, and I'm stealing this from Bill Barnwell, but he tweeted out this stat, and I think this speaks to there could be no more Browns stat than this. They are +5 in takeaways today. The Browns were +5 since the Browns returned to the NFL. Teams with a turnover margin of +5 or better in games are 132-4-1. The Browns are responsible for two of those losses and the tie. Who wanted to win this game was the two defenses. The two defenses played to win this game. The two offenses, not so much. And I tweeted this 4 or 5 times, and I'll say it one more. This is the kind of play you get when your offensive starters play 3 series in the preseason.
I understand not playing some preseason football. Let's just scrap the whole entire thing. Let's let these guys practice a little longer. Let's add another week to the NFL season while we're at it. Let's start it a little bit earlier as well. And then you got, an extra home game or maybe an extra game played in the UK or wherever neutral site they might want to do, like college likes to do. I was talking about this. Here's some interesting stuff with the Steelers. You wouldn't have thought this with the torrential downpour. In fact, I'm gonna make a comment at the tail end of this that, you know, you're trying to think. 17 first downs by the Steelers passing the ball. 17-7, and they only acquired one first down via penalty, whereas they gave six first downs to the Cleveland Browns via penalty, and of course a gift of a turnover right on the doorstep of the goal line, where Ben is trying to knock his shoulder out, taking out was it Jabril Peppers who ended up with the ball. And man, I'll tell you what a crazy play. There was a little bit of crazy everywhere, but someone else here would have been like, oh, well, you know what, this slop and how well James Conner was running, I mean, obviously before the fumble, and you know, the weather conditions play into that somewhat as well. But someone somewhere had to be thinking, fire Todd Haley. No, that was the other side of the ball, and he gave us enough gifts as well throughout the game.
Yeah, I mean, both teams had opportunities to put the game away, especially in that overtime. But yeah, this is, I think somebody else tweeted this out. The Steelers were something like $8 billion in O when they had over a 14-point lead in the fourth quarter. Well, I guess that stat's gone now. It's hard to see them blow a 14-point lead. But as you said, you can't put that on the defense. The offense was bad except for one guy. And again, I'm reiterate that this is the guy who played a lot in the preseason. That would be James Conner. He had one miscue. He did fumble the ball on one play. And, you know, hey, that happens. I think he more than made up for it with 135 rushing yards, two TDs, as well as, 57 yards passing. He played well enough to make people, kind of go, okay, whatever, Le'Veon, do what you want, and probably force Le'Veon to consider jumping on an airplane. Had the Steelers won this game, I'm sure he would have been back in Pittsburgh in a heartbeat. Considering it ended in a tie, he may feel compelled to stay another week out. But we'll see. We'll see how that drama unfolds the rest of the week. But the rest of them, Ben and AB were just not in sync. At least one of the interceptions and several incompletions were because Ben thought AB was going one way. He ended up going another, and they were not in sync at all. And that was, you know, Juju had a really nice game, but man, it was tough to watch.
Quite a bit of Juju off of the 67-yard reception that he had, quite a bit there. And then he was almost like a lot of these guys non-existent. And remember, this went through week 5 last year. Until Ben threw 5 picks, with 2 of which were pick sixes. Does the old gunslinger still have it? This stuff is going to start up all over again. And you know what else is going to start up? Well, if they had Le'Veon Bell, they would have won this game easily. Not necessarily. That was another thing that I said as a guest up there with Cleveland. They were like, you know, you're worried about Le'Veon Bell. They were excited that the Steelers didn't have Le'Veon Bell. I said, well, pop the brakes on that. James Conner is looking sharp, and as you alluded to, he did look like a man. By the way, it wasn't passing, it was receiving, but we all know what you meant. On the 5 catches, 57 yards. He should have had a third touchdown, actually. And, you know, those type of penalties, you're self-defeating each other. There was just some garbage in the game I didn't think should have been called at all on either side of the ball, to be completely honest with everyone here. And there were some that was okay, calls and stuff, but it's just like, oh my goodness. You see some holds, you see the one that really bothered me was in overtime, and Antonio Brown, there was a play that Ben nearly had him like a back shoulder, and whoever was covering Brown just never turned around to look for the ball ever at all. And I'm just thinking to myself there, that's usually when all the little hankies come out all over the field. I was actually expecting one of the touchdowns to come back. I'm like, I'm just waiting for the replay rule here to say it wasn't a catch. That was the Antonio Brown touchdown that he did have. And, I mean, I was saying that in jest, partially because it was like, you know, the football gods did not want the Steelers to score. I don't know. I don't know where to go with a lot of this. I mean, Jesse James had one skip off his hands. There's a lot of jitters. There's a lot with weather. I think Justin Hunter being used out there was kind of there was like, you know, one or two where it was okay. He should have had a touchdown. One of those was called back. But then I think there were other times that maybe it was still that lingering, hey, he's not in the place he's supposed to be. But this just goes to show you folks that these type of things had nothing to do with Todd Haley. Now everybody's going to come back and say, oh, well, it's Mike Tomlin. Oh, yeah, of course. It's Mike Tomlin, too. No, there's a lot of ugly football. If you have the ability to watch any replays in some of these other games, I think the closest game to this of the ones I was able to flip and kind of see on a second screen, there's Jimmy Garoppolo's three picks playing the Minnesota Vikings, the 49ers and Vikings, and that was pretty much back and forth, and there was some defensive struggle in that as well. But there's several games like that. There's several more that are on going as we're recording, and it's just that's just the way it is. So you have a mobile quarterback in Tyrod Taylor. You know what, they couldn't say anybody's name right today, could they? Trent Green. Yeah. What a goof. And then you got Bruce Arians, who says he's wide ass open, which is just, that's great. Somebody didn't have the sensor button on Brucey there. But you know who had a worse QB rating though than Roethlisberger? That Tyrod Taylor, 15 of 40, 15 of 40, 197 yards, one TD, one pick, 51.8. He was running for his life. I don't know that I still want to talk about the offense anymore. There's just nothing there, I think, that was even remotely redeemable. You had penalties by both of your edge guys with your tackles. And I don't know, it was just blah. I like wanted to throw up all over the screen watching the Cleveland Browns at various times. And Ben just held onto the ball forever. Dare I say he looked like Landry Jones-ish. Maybe he was making a stand for him. I don't know. But
I just think, you know, look, we said all week the Browns are a better team than they were last year. And their defense wasn't bad last year, and it's going to be better this year. Denzel Ward is the real deal, clearly. You know, he played a really solid game. You know, they're a better team. Now,
he was lucky. He was also in the right spot at the right time on the picks, too. But,
absolutely.
Yes, he played a solid game.
One of Marcus Gilbert's holds, because I think he got called for two, one of them was legitimate. The other one, the guy fell down. Look, I tweeted it, and again, I said something like, I'm going to say this for the first time this season, but I'm sure it won't be the last. The refs stink. They stink. They continue to stink. This game, because of the way it was called, not saying that all the penalties were not legitimate. A lot of them were, but a lot of them weren't. And in addition to that, some of the no calls were as egregious as the bad calls. Bud Dupree nearly gets killed with a peelback block. And I'm sorry, that's a penalty every time. And if the Steelers did it, that's what Juju Smith-Schuster got called for against Vontaze Burfict, on top of the taunting. But again, other things. That's a peelback block. He's going back towards his end zone. It was obvious. The pass interference that you were talking about against Antonio Brown. You know, on top of that, they tried to call a timeout when they didn't have any timeouts.
That
I understand
garbage.
That, but it's a penalty. You can't do that. I get it. You think you want the refs to do it, but you know, you got to make your case a different way. You can't just decide to break the rules to get the refs to do it, and then the refs let them. I'm already disgusted with them.
Well, how about Jarvis Landry's nice little sell job across the middle of the field where, you know, who was covering him? Was it Hilton? Was it Davis? And there was just like, there was nothing there. And he like threw his arm up as though he got like, you know, murdered in the middle of the field. And then the flag came out late. And it's just like, and that extended a play too. And some of these just, they weren't critical to the game, or they could have been. It's like one of those things where, well, if this call isn't there, then what do the Steelers do? Or if this call isn't there, you know, that one that extends it, maybe the Browns are punting and the Steelers have better field position. Maybe they drive. Maybe they get a field goal at some point. So, you know, you could say coulda, woulda, shoulda. It really should have been a Steelers victory. It didn't have to be a Steelers victory based on how bad they were playing. They also deserved to lose. So I guess a tie is the only fair thing. And for all the Browns fans, if there's anybody from Cleveland that happens to be listening in and they're like, this guy's full of it, oh, I'm sorry, you didn't get the Bud Light fridges to open. I don't think it works that way unless you have more points than the opponent. Equaling points. Hey, this is a victory for them. It's better than losing. They're used to losing a lot. They just would have probably liked the victory there. This game scared me immediately. It definitely wasn't a shoe-in for sure. And we keep looking ahead, too. You know, they got the Kansas City Chiefs coming up next week, and they come out with a hot start, too. We'll see how their game ends up finishing. I want to talk about defense, but it just in one moment here, because I do want to bring up Total Sports Enterprises Steelers public signing. If you're interested in getting an item or any items that they happen to sell at TSC autographed on September 15th, this upcoming Saturday, Chris Boswell, Marcus Allen, Morgan Burnett, and I guess Vance McDonald's going to limp into there. Man, they could have used him today too, but those four gentlemen will be signing autographs. You could purchase a ticket in order to reserve your spot today at tseshop.com. That's tseshop.com for Total Sports Enterprises. Now, defense, you don't get to say it today because they have grown ass men on that field.
Yes, they did.
TJ freaking Watt. I mean, I'm speechless. I really don't know what to say about TJ Watt. I don't know. Like four sacks. I'm like, did he really have four sacks? I think some of that's
four
just,
sacks.
I think some of that's just Taylor like rumbling around, and you know, it was for 21 yards, so I guess he had to stop him behind the line a couple of times for it to count statistically. John Bostic, Bud Dupree. Hey, I'll tell you what, this switch with Dupree playing on the right and Watt playing on the left, Watt was definitely a beneficiary on the one of Dupree just jacking Harrison all the way back into Taylor, and Taylor goes to move, and he's right in the waiting arms of TJ Watt. I know a lot of people are going to say, blah, 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 like Bud Dupree, this and that. I thought Bud Dupree had a very nice game. The linebackers in general, very nice game overall. Let me see. Did I miss anybody? I said Bostic had a sack too, so I thought they gave up seven. I'm looking here. Yeah, it was seven sacks.
Hayward. Cam Hayward.
Oh, yeah, Cam.
Grown-ass man had a sack.
Yeah, because they held to it. And then declined the penalty because Cam got him behind the spot of the foul. I mean, they held the Browns 327 net yards, not a whole lot passing, more rushing 177. Some of that was the quarterback scrambling. Some of that was like seven or eight straight run plays on the one drive, the one solid drive that the Browns actually did have put together. That was of their own accord and not a gift off of a turnover. And let me see. I'm looking for something here. 150 yards passed. Passing. So they forced only one turnover, though, which is the Cam Sutton interception versus the Steelers turning it over six times. So, and then, of course, TJ with the big play afterward on at the very end on special teams, getting his paw on the ball and at least saving a loss to not only a division but conference opponent, which will come into play later on. But, I mean, the tie, that sucks even more. I mean, I really feel for Chris Boswell not making that kick.
Yeah, you know, look, you knew that they were jinxed when Bruce Arians said that Cam Kennedy has had a problem with bad snaps. And first of all, I don't know that he has, but just him saying that, it was like, okay, this snap's going to be high, or it's going to be off, or something's going to go wrong. Sure enough, it was a high snap. You know, Barry had to go up and get it. And Boz shanked it. I mean, you pulled it a little bit, what, right or left? I don't know. I can't tell directions anymore after this game.
North.
But, yeah, north. There you go. Normally when Boswell lines up to kick a field goal and it's a game winner, you feel confident. But the way this game had gone, the ebb and flow of this game, just the karma and the vibe of this game, you didn't feel like, okay, this is going to be the end of the game. It's going to be over. You felt like, no, he's going to miss. Even when the Browns guy lines up for a field goal that's a yard longer, you didn't go, okay, yeah, they're going to lose now. You kind of went, nope, it's going to not work. It's going to be a tie. And that's just how it's going to go down.
It was the Buffalo Wild Wings commercial, but over and over.
Yeah. And speaking of Buffalo, man, do they stink. But, okay. I don't want to get into other teams because, you know, don't throw those in glass houses, and we kind of stunk today. But, you know, the defense, look, if you want to take the positives away from this, the defense played a really solid game. Yes, they had some breakdowns at times. They still had a couple communication issues, but they did – it was much cleaner. Look, hopefully Joe Hayden is not seriously hurt with his hamstring. Because that's
rubble,
a problem.
Rubble.
Yeah. And if Cam Sutton – look, Cam Sutton got burnt, and then he came back and made a play. He's like, you fooled me once. Second time I got you.
I don't know that he got burnt. I mean, he's there, and he's got his arms up. And, I mean, I don't know what else you do there.
It was a solid catch, yeah.
I was defending him to other people as well.
He got, let's just say he got. I don't know that he got burnt, but he got. He got picked on.
I don't know that that's right either.
TD. The guy made the catch and he was defending it.
Yeah.
So,
it'll give him a 40 ranking. It'll give him a 40 rating on Pro Football Focus from what we've learned.
Yeah. And he got the pick the second time around. He said, all right, I know what you're going to try again. And this time I'm going to be ready for it. Sean Davis had some nice plays. You know,
yes, he did. He looked great, by the way.
Than I expected. I thought he was really solid playing center field and as a free safety in his first thing. I think, Artie thought he was wearing some Bengals gear for a second there. I don't know how else to describe the meltdown he had. But, you know, people are losing it. But remember, he's a kid, and he's still a kid. He's a very young man. And young men sometimes get in their feels and, you know, lose it. So that's what happened there. But he didn't, you know, it's not like he made that same mistake later in the game. And overall, I think he had a solid game minus that one kerfuffle.
Sure. I thought so, too. I'm hoping we're not jinxed with Joe Hayden being hurt and out for a few weeks. They need him on the field. He was lights out for, like, the entire game. Pretty much.
Yeah,
even
really
in
played well.
Yeah.
Yeah, really, really played well up until the point where he got hurt. You know, so we'll see. I am encouraged. Look, seven sacks is a lot of sacks in a game. That's like Madden numbers of sacks in a game. And T.J. Watt getting four, you know, I guess we can pretty safely say T.J. Watt will be leading the league in sacks after the first game because I don't see anybody else getting four sacks. So, you know, they got seven sacks. They gave up four. Myles Garrett had a solid game for the Browns and was definitely causing Big Al a lot of problems and Ben a lot of problems. You know, they have to clean up a lot of stuff on the offensive side of the ball. But the defensive side of the ball, if we want to take – what silver lining we can away from this game. If the offense hadn't put the defense in horrible positions, they probably still win this game despite how bad the offense played. But, you know, you can only overcome so much.
Yeah. Oh, I totally agree with you on that. And you could only hold the fort for so long. Now, wow. I look at the stat line. I mean, T.J. Watt was very impressive, but I also liked let's throw John Bostic a bone here for the two tackles for loss as well. Dupree with two pass deflections and a forced fumble. And then Sean Davis with two deflections. Mike Hilton. Maybe we may have grown-ass men all over the place on the defense. I was calling him the glove. That needs to stick, man, because, wow, he's just so good, and the blitz with him as well, a good call. Here's the one that bugged me. There's a couple spots in the game that bothered me, actually, and I'm trying to remember what it was. Was it 3rd and 10, and they're up, you know, the two scores, 14 points, and I'm thinking to myself, you know, you could put this game away, and I thought they got a little too conservative, and then it went to 4th and 5, and I don't know necessarily you need to go that aggressive and go for it, but I felt like they didn't put their foot on the Cleveland Browns' throat at that point. The one that really got me, and this is a lot of its execution. Most of this isn't coaching, except for when you get to, you know, the end of the game in OT and you have too many guys on the field. What are you doing? First of all, what are you doing bringing Bud Dupree out for Anthony Ciccolo? I do not understand that whatsoever. He's not a better athlete. I don't know what he gives you unless unless there was some hand signal to Priest hurt or what, and it didn't appear that way for me. He's gashed. You got somebody on a snap count or something goofy. You only have three outside linebackers on the depth chart for this game anyway. And I'm just like, you know, why? And then I knew immediately when they did that, and that the Browns have no timeouts, that you're gonna try and pull Chick back off of the field and somebody else, and you're trying to run the Gravedigger out there as part of a substitute as well, and he no run that fast. So
yeah.
And I'm surprised the referees actually caught it, because the Browns, they weren't prepared. You know what? You get up against somebody, let's say the Green Bay Packers, and it's Aaron Rodgers, they're going to catch that immediately and take a free play. And then they may score on that free play, or at least they get that shot and they say, thank you, now I'll have another, because then it's a 5-yard penalty and first down and whatever. That was a gigantic mess. And I'm just like, you know what? This is falling apart again. It felt like Jacksonville, the Jacksonville games at times. Did it not? That's the vibe I got from it.
Oh, absolutely. Well, you know, when the balls start falling the wrong way, look, the first interception is just Ben having a knucklehead moment, because he should have never tried to force that ball in there.
Three guys.
Yeah, you know, it's crazy. The second interception, again, I think that's a miscommunication. That's Ben and AB not being on the same page. The third one goes off Jesse James's hands. That's more on Jesse James, who should have caught that ball, than it is on Ben. I don't even remember the fourth, other than it was probably something dumb.
Oh, that was the one where it was like almost like I don't think they counted it as a fumble. They counted it as like maybe a strip sack. He got hit as he was trying to release the ball forward. And
right.
It kind of just like fluttered like a butterfly into the hands of whoever caught it. It may have been Denzel Ward's second touchdown there, possibly. Or was it Schobert that got it? One or the other, you know, and now some of it like just gets muddled together. Having not the ability to rewatch. Speaking of, did you think Bud Dupree was offside on that one play that he got flagged for? I thought it was very close. I thought they did it just based on the flinch. I thought he jumped that snap. Just like I thought he had the timing down so good that he fooled the referees. My personal
his footwork made it look like he thought he was offsides. I didn't get an angle that was good from the TV feed, so I could never really see. Is he truly offsides? But it's one of those plays where, because he stutter stepped it, made him look guilty, so the flag comes out.
Yeah, if you're not sure what we're talking about there with the TV angle, folks, if you do have the ability to rewatch this, and I'm going to try this myself, is you don't have a straight line 90 degree angle from sideline to sideline. So what you want to kind of do is where the line of scrimmage is. Take like a piece of paper or something, a ruler or something, put it up against the screen or something that's a straight edge. If you got it on the computer, you may be able to like draw a line over it if you got a snap. And I think I'm going to try and do that and see like right where it snapped if he was off. I know it was awful close, and I'm just like, I'm not sure. I just thought, again, there's another thing that could have been different. So I'm not sure. I'm not sure that people should be freaking out. If every game's like this, it's going to be a long season. Every game is like this in week one and week two and maybe even week three. You know, they're going to have one that's going to be, you know, everybody's going to be happy. They're going to be on their high. Everybody's going to be toasting at the water cooler on Monday. And then you're going to go back to the next Sunday, and it's going to be fire everybody to clear out the locker rooms. And let's like bomb this thing like John Gruden and start from scratch.
Look, yeah, I want to say one thing about the people who are going to be going, well, if Le'Veon Bell was here, they'd have won. Please go back and look at what Le'Veon Bell's stats were in the first game last year. Compare those to Connor's stats in this game this year. Le'Veon Bell coming in, if he had come in on Labor Day as everyone expected, he wasn't going to have this kind of game. I would go as far to say that if Le'Veon Bell is in this game as the starter, they lose. Because they are going to lose James Conner's production, and it's not even going to be close.
James Conner, 4.4 yards per carry in this game, 22-yard long. I'm actually looking for the other long plays. Of course, he had the 22-yarder was a touchdown. He had another 4-yard touchdown. I'm totally with you on this, Brian. Let's talk about somebody else that had good and bad averages. Jordan Berry. A net 37.1. He had three that were inside the 20. He punted seven times. It wasn't necessarily the greatest. I think his last one was the best one. I think that was the 53-yarder. But he had a couple of ducks early, maybe also weather-related, depending on how bad or how much it was raining. I absolutely freaking love Ryan Switzer, his vision and his...
Oh, fantastic.
And ball security. Thank you. Praise the Lord, because if that was like Fitz Toussaint or Eli Rogers back there, I was even sweating it because I still don't know that Ryan Switzer is that guy, but he looks pretty darn good.
Yeah, I tweeted it out. I said, again, you know, you want to take something else positive from this game, Ryan Switzer is infinitely better than anything they've had in the receiving, returning core in the last, I don't even know how many
decade.
Years.
Other than Antonio Brown.
He even makes you feel okay that Antonio Brown's not sacrificing more of his body to catch punts. You know, he much better on kickoff returns. He's much more elusive. He made some positive yards out of, you know, nothing in a couple situations on punt returns. Do I expect him to be a big burst away, going to score a lot of touchdown kind of guys? No, but I think he's a consistent threat to get positive yards on returns. And that's something they haven't had. I will say, as far as his contributions within the offense, that was a little less enthusiastic. But, you know, he hasn't had a lot of time there yet. He's got to get ingrained in the system. It was definitely a good sign from that standpoint. And look, let's if we're going to call it special teams, let's also note – Tyler Matakevich was a monster on special teams. He was a monster on special teams today. He was all over the field making tackles. Danny Smith has done a great job in getting the right guys to play special teams. The special teams has been much improved last year, and it looks like they're continuing to be good this year. Coverage was really solid throughout the game.
Yep, and 21 all, final score. Chris Boswell nearly missed an extra point as well. So I don't know. Maybe some of this is the field is slop. You could take it, hopefully. If that's the, you know what, and it's not trying to make an excuse for anyone whatsoever. But, I mean, with neither team being able to come away with this. But, I mean, the Browns, it's got to be a negative for them that they gave up the ball so much it didn't win the game. And for the Steelers, it's got to be a positive that they gave up the ball so much and didn't lose the game. And I think that's where I leave this.
Yeah, I don't know who it was, and I'm too lazy to go look it up again. One of the Browns defenders came off the field and saying, five turnovers for a tie? For a tie? You know, they have to be the defense of the Browns has to be frustrated that they gave the offense that many opportunities and ended up tying the game. Whereas on the flip side of that, you can say the Steelers defense has to basically say, we feel pretty darn good. Our offense really let us down today with giving the ball up six times, and we only gave up 21 points. You know, this ball game should have been over long before had the Browns had any semblance of an offense at all. You know, this was Tyrod Taylor making his case for why Baker Mayfield maybe should get a start sooner than later.
Or even Todd Haley, who got a nice little hug from Antonio Brown, which is hilarious. And it just looked like it took Todd right out of his element, didn't it? But, well, I mean, now maybe better weather when they get a rematch October 28th back at Heinz Field. Maybe we'll actually see. Well, we'll see. We'll see if it's still Tyrod Taylor's team and Hugh Jackson's team. Man, he was fired up on the sideline trying to fight for everything. But I'm like, Hugh, just shut up. Like, I don't know. He just grates me. Like, the only guy who's worse than that, I mean, Jim Harbaugh is out of the league, but Marvin Lewis just kind of. He just had that, like, stare. But you know what? Around the AFC North, Baltimore and the Bengals 1-0 out the gate. The other two teams 0-0-1. And that's going to be goofy. It's going to be goofy going forward. Steelers, that just means they got to work that much harder and acquire that many more wins. They should have had this one in the bag. Oh, well, I mean, it's still, I'll take it over a loss. I don't know what else to say other than I was swearing quite a bit at various times, and I was swearing when Cam Sutton got it. I'm thinking, just like everyone else is thinking, you give Big Ben the ball with anything like 40, 50 seconds remaining in a game and a timeout or something. You think you have it. You think going to overtime and, you know, the Steelers don't get the ball first. The Browns have it. Oh, dear Lord. Here we go again. This is this Tim Tebow crap. They somehow survive it, and they survive it again and survive it again, and then just nobody wins the game, and it sucks. And I hate it. But we'll be looking ahead. We're going to see we're going to look ahead at the Kansas City Chiefs here a little bit later in the week. May have a special episode or two here on the podcast for you in between then. I have no other closing remarks. I like the defense. I thought the offense, Piusa. I thought the run, the guys up front, the offensive line, run blocking, great. Pass blocking, stinketh. And Big Ben, stinketh. Antonio Brown need to get on the same pageth. And aside from the one big catch by Juju Smith-Schuster, you got to show up when AB isn't there too. But this sounds a whole lot like last year when we were saying that about Martavis Bryant. We were saying Ben and AB weren't on the same page. The only thing that's different is that Connor was very sharp and looked very good and put up some stats that Bell did not. And if Bell happens to come back and they happen to play him, then you may add that into the equation if they still look as rotten.
Yeah, dilly-dilly.
Dilly-dilly, I agree. They locked the guy in there for the autumnal, I can't even say it, autumnal mead.
Autumnal.
I drink craft beer, and I don't even say stupid stuff like that. So, but I am in agreement with you, and I feel like locking some people in the dungeon, but before I do that, I'm going to get out of here so there's no witnesses. Yeah. So, thanks, Brian, and until next time, my name's Joe, his name's Brian. Be safe, be good. And try not to hurt anybody out there, right? We'll catch you later.
We would like to thank you for listening and remind our listeners to follow us on social media and our website, www.steelcityunderground.com.